Hello everyone. So let's get started with the last session on underground cables. So the learning objectives of this particular session is, so you'll be solving some of the problems in order to find out the insulation resistance, intersheath radius and maximum stress for a given conditions. Okay, we will be able to solve some of the problems in order to find the insulation resistance, intersheath radius and maximum stress. We will continue with the problems that we had discussed in the last session. So let's get started with the problem. So a single core cable is having a conductor diameter of 4 cm and it consists of 3 insulating materials A, B and C. The insulating materials have a permittivity of 4, 3 and 2. The dielectric stresses are 40, 30 and 20 kilovolt per centimeter. If the line is designed for 140 kV, you're supposed to find out the minimum internal sheath radius of the cable. Okay, so let's start. First, let us note down the values that we know, formulas, expressions that we know in order to find out the unknowns that are asked. So Gmax 1 by Gmax 2 is equal to epsilon 2 r1 divided by epsilon 1 small r. So on substituting these value of Gmax 1 and Gmax 2, that is 40 and 30 kV per centimeter, and epsilon 2 value is 3 and you'll r1 is unknown, so epsilon 1 is 4, small r radius is 2. So on further simplifying this, the value of r1 will correspond to 3.55 centimeter. So next we will move on to the next part, that is Gmax 2 and Gmax 3, because you have the value of 3 dielectric stresses are given for 3 insulating materials. So all the values need to be considered. So Gmax 2 by Gmax 3 is equal to epsilon 3 R2 divided by epsilon 2 R1. On substituting these values, you will get a value 0.187 R2. So the value of R2 can further be simplified as, the value of R2 you will get it as 8 centimeters. The working voltage of the cable is given in the problem. So it is V is equal to V1 plus V2 plus V3. The working voltage over here is nothing but 140 kilovolts. Working voltage is nothing but 140 kilovolts. So V1 is nothing but Gmax 1 R ln capital R1 by small r. So the value of V1 over here is, after you substitute the value of Gmax 1 and small r value, you will get a value of V1 as 45.90 kilovolts. So V2 is nothing but Gmax 2 R1 ln R2 by R1. So again you substitute the value of Gmax 2 and the value of capital R1, you will get a value of V2 as 86.53 kilovolts. So value of V3 is nothing but Gmax 3 R2 ln R3 by R2. So this value, because we do not know the value of capital R3, so you will substitute the values that you know, that is Gmax 3 is nothing but 20, R2 value is 8, so R3 is as it is. Okay, on substituting all these values, the known values, it will be easy for you to calculate the value of unknown R3. Okay, on further simplification, this will be the expression. Further, it is simplified. This is the next expression. You are removing the ln, so you will get shifted to e power 0.0473. So the value of R3 will correspond to 8.384 centimeter. So this is the value of minimum internal sheath radius of the cable. The minimum internal sheath radius of the cable is nothing but 8.384 centimeters. Let's move on to the next problem. A single core cable has a conductor diameter of 2.5 centimeters and a sheath of inside diameter 6 cm. You're supposed to calculate the maximum stress. It is desired to reduce the maximum stress by using 2 intersheets. Okay, it is desired to reduce the maximum stress by using 2 intersheets. Determine their best positions, the maximum stress, and the voltages on each system. System voltage is given as 66 kV 3-phase. It's an examination problem. System peak voltage per phase, V peak, is nothing but 66 divided by root 3 into root 2. You will get a value of this as 53.88 kV. The maximum stress in the absence, first you are supposed to calculate the stress in the absence of intersheath. So G max is nothing but V divided by small r ln R3 by R, as we have used this expression in our previous problems. The value of V is nothing but 53.88, small r value is 1.25 ln 3 divided by 1.25. Okay, so the value of G max is nothing but 49.24 kilovolt per centimeters. So for equal maximum and minimum stresses, what will be the value of this radii? So you will be considering it as R1 by small r is equal to R2 by R1 is equal to R3 by R2, which is nothing but alpha. Okay, therefore on substitution, what will be the value of these? On substitution, what will be the value of these? The value of alpha is nothing but 1.338. The value of alpha is nothing but 1.338. Radius of intersheets R1 is equal to alpha R. Radius of intersheets R1 is nothing but alpha into small r. 1.338 into 1.25. Okay, so this value of R1 will be nothing but 1.673 centimeters. What is the value of R2? It is alpha times R1. So this value of R2 is nothing but 2.238 centimeters. So using the equations of intersheath grading, we can therefore write V is nothing but V1 plus V2 plus V3. Okay, on using this expression and substituting the values, you will get these values. You will get a value of G max as 36.67 kV per kilovolt per centimeter. So this will be the value for G max. The voltages on the 2 intersheath peak voltages are, so V max 1 is nothing but G max R ln R1 by R. So you will get this value as 13.34 kilovolts. And what is the value of V max 2? G max R1 into ln R2 by R1. So the value of V max 2 is nothing but 17.86 kV is the value of V max 2. The peak voltage on the surface of the conductor, we have calculated it initially, that corresponds to 53.88 kV. So how do you calculate the peak voltage on the first intersheath? It's a peak minus Vmax, because Vmax is the voltage at the initial intersheath. So therefore, peak voltage on the first intersheath is nothing but V peak minus Vmax 1. Which is nothing but 53.88 minus 13.34. So you will get a value of peak voltage on the first intersheath as 40.54 kV. So the peak voltage on the second intersheath is equal to peak voltage on the first intersheath minus Vmax 2. Second intersheath is equal to peak voltage on the first intersheath minus Vmax 2. So this value of second intersheath, peak voltage on the second intersheath will correspond to 22.68 kV. So the next problem, A 66 kV three-phase system uses single core cables of conductor diameter 2 cm and the outer lead sheath diameter is 5.3 cm. The two intersheets of diameters 3.1 cm and 4.2 cm are introduced between the core and the outer lead sheath. If the insulating material used throughout is the same and if the maximum stress in the layers is also same, you're supposed to find the voltages on the intersheets. So the value of D is 2 cm as given in the problem. So the small r will be 1 cm. Capital D1 diameter is nothing but 3.1 cm. That radius 1 is nothing but 1.55 cm. So D2 is 4.2 cm. The value of R2 is 2.1 cm. So the value of R3 is nothing but D3 by 2, which is nothing but 2.65 cm. So again, the peak value you're supposed to find 66 into root 2 by root 3. You'll get a value of peak as 53.9 kV. So you are assuming that the maximum stress in the layers are equal. Okay. And in the problem is it is also given. Maximum stress in the layers is also same. So therefore, Gmax 1 is equal to Gmax 2 is equal to Gmax 3. So on substituting the values of Gmax 1, Gmax 2, Gmax 3, or in other words, expressions of V1, V2, and V3, you get it as 2.28 V1, which is equal to 2.12 V2, which is equal to 2.04 V3. So therefore, the value of V2 is nothing but 1.075 V1. So V3 is again 1.117 V1. So you know that V1 plus V2 plus V3 is equal to V. On substituting these values of V2 and V3 and also V, you can find out the unknown V1 value. So V1 over here is nothing but 16.88 kV and the value of V2 is 118.14 kV. Okay, so now let's find out the voltage on the first intersheet. It's nothing but V minus V1. So it is 53.9 minus 16.88, which corresponds to 37.02 kilovolts. And voltage on the second intersheet is nothing but V minus V1 minus V2. So you will get this value as 18.88 kV. So let's move on to the last concepts in UG cable, advantages and limitations of UG cables. So again, we have discussed a lot about UG cables. You know, they are used for power transmission instead of overhead power lines. And again, they have their own disadvantages that you cannot use UG cable for long distance power transmission. Okay. So they have their own advantages and disadvantages when you compare it with overhead lines. Let's get started with advantages. So they are well suited for urban areas where overhead lines are difficult to install. And one more major advantages of UG cables are it will enhance the aesthetics of the city because the lines will not be visible, especially when the land has natural and environmental heritage. Okay, when the land has natural and environmental heritage, it will enhance the aesthetics of the city. Because lines are laid underground. Okay, they save the land for further urban expansion, where usually when right of way is expensive, when you have to get permissions from certain authorities, when that is too time consuming. So it'll be easy for urban expansion. The land can be saved for urban expansion. Since they are not exposed, they are less subjected to damage from severe weather conditions. So since all currents produce electromagnetic field, the shielding provided by the earth surrounding the cable restricts the range and the power of penetration of these emissions to the surrounding area. This is a major advantage. They also need a narrow surrounding strip of about 1 to 10 meters to install as compared to overhead lines, which need 20 to 200 meters for safety, maintenance, and repair. So this is in terms of its installation. This is in terms of its installation. They do not pose a hazard to low-flying aircraft, wildlife, and birds. They are not easily prone to theft, illegal connections, or sabotage. Very few faults can occur. Some of the limitations are they are very expensive. Fault detection, since it is lead underground, it's difficult. Restoration takes longer time than overhead lines. Because it's lead underground, it's very difficult to identify the faults that are inside, and if at all it has to be repaired, it takes more time when compared to overhead lines. Okay, they cannot be maintained live due to proximity effect. High charging current makes voltage control more difficult. If the charging currents are high, again, because you can say that you can operate at higher voltages, but the voltage control will also be tedious. Some of the specifications of power cables. So it's very simple, it's general. Main thing, people see the rating of the power cable. It's very much important. Whenever you select it for a particular installation, you should know its rating. Okay, you should, and it should have the capacity to withstand the short circuit current than the sustained current. And during short circuit, there will be a sudden inrush of current for a certain amount of time, steadier flow for a short period. So the cable selected should be capable enough to withstand the short circuit current until the suitable circuit breaker or any other protective device operates. Current carrying capacity again is very, very important. Depends, optimum selection of conductor size actually depends on its ampacity and voltage drop. The safe current carrying capacity of a power cable is decided by the maximum allowable temperature rise. Okay, so if you just consider an in-ground cables with a ground temperature of 30 degrees Celsius, is 103 amperes for a conductor size of 2 core into 16 millimeter square. And for the remaining design is as mentioned in the slide. It is as mentioned in the slide. Voltage drop. The permissible maximum voltage drop from source to load is also one of the important aspects in order to select the UG cable. Copper is a better conductor when compared to aluminium, mainly because it has less voltage drop for a given length and wire size. Wire size is also an important factor that has to be considered in determining the voltage drop. So wires with large diameter will have less voltage drop than smaller wire sizes of the same length. Okay, so this is with respect to specifications of power cable. So in this session today, we solved some of the problems in finding the stress and thickness. Later, we moved on to knowing the advantages and disadvantages of UG cables when you compare that with overhead lines. And we also got to know the specifications that are very important parameters that has to be known in order to select the cable. That is its current carrying capacity, voltage drop, rating of the cable. Okay, so these are some of the important specifications of power cables. So with this, we will be completing module 4. So in module 4, we discussed about corona phenomenon. We solved some of the problems, critical disruptive voltage, visual critical voltage, power loss. And we also discussed about UG cables, capacitance of a single core cable, types of cables, specifications, advantages and disadvantages of UG cables, along with some of the problems that are normally asked in the examination. Okay, thank you.